Thomas is a morning show anchor for Fox 2 Detroit and a well-known movie critic. But before his career took off, he was an army brat.
Growing up in a military family, for me, it was, I guess, structured. It was very respectful and very loving. I mean, I don't know if I, well, literally I wouldn't be here without my brothers and sisters. But my dad, who was an officer in the Army, a chief warrant officer, he set it up so that we could kind of, we always felt at home as long as we were all together. So I lived in Oklahoma, Fort Sill, Oklahoma. I was born in Fort Belvoir. We moved to Addis Ababa in Ethiopia when I was a kid as well. Lived in Africa for 2.5-3 years. And never skipped a beat, because as long as my other brothers and sisters and mom and dad were there, I was kind of fine with everything. And also, I loved growing up military. And I know this is a long answer, but it gave me a respect for people. That's one thing that you inherently have. And a respect for the military, because people give their lives and their families' lives in dedication to country. Now, they get paid, don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, people choose to fight for our freedom. And that's something that's deep.
When did you decide you wanted to be on TV?
When I was 7 years old, I saw this guy named Rodney Allen Rippey in a commercial. And he was the first little black kid I'd ever seen on TV talking to the camera. And right then, I was like, I can do that, you know. I also, my brothers and sisters can tell you, I have five of them. I also said that we could be the Thomas Five, like the Jackson Five. I could be the Michael, and I'd be the lead singer, and they'd back me up. That didn't go over big. So I went to TV next, and like, I can do that. And that's the first time I ever said, I can do that. But then when I got in college, I was studying theater, because I had grown up from like 7 all the way on acting. Because when I saw Rodney Allen Rippey, I thought, mm-hmm. to be on TV, you had to be an actor. And I went to college, and I started getting jobs. I got hired to do a industrial, like infomercial kind of thing. Like, thank you, John, that's an interesting part. How does that work? Doing that kind of stuff. And so, one time they hired me, and instead of like it being a character like John and Billy or Jasper or whatever, they actually said it was going to be me just talking. And then this guy was holding cue cards. And once I got paid to be me just talking and I didn't have to memorize anything, I was like, this is for me. This is for me.
That's when he got his start in broadcasting.
I got a job in New York. Lucky, my first job was in New York. And I was covering the LA riots and for Channel One. It's a high school news program. And so I covered the LA riots, and it was so disturbing on so many levels. So many different things happened. I said, you know, I love entertainment. If I'm going to stay in this business as a broadcast journalist, I want to cover entertainment. And if I'm not covering entertainment, I'm going to go back to acting. Because I really enjoyed it. I was decent at it. And I said, I may not be famous, but I'll make a living, mm-hmm. you know, regional theater, whatever. I really wasn't looking for fame. I was just looking to have a career that I was going to enjoy. I've been a movie critic for probably 10 or 12 years now, officially. I've been interviewing celebrities. I covered my first Oscar working for Channel One in 1991. So I've been covering entertainment for a very long time. I've been a movie critic for probably 12 years, and I love it. I love theater. I love movies. I love telling stories.
And what's your favorite movie?
My favorite movie right now?
Yeah.
Oh my God, I love movies so much.
How many hours a day do you like, or how many hours a week do you spend watching
Watch movies? Okay, so I see about 4 movies a week, sometimes 6. So about 2 hours a movie, probably 8 or 10 hours a week, just watching movies. And if I had to pick one movie, because I've thought about this and I've asked myself this, one movie that kind of has all of the elements that make a great movie, it's Gladiator with Russell Crowe, if I had to pick a modern film. And the reason I say that, it's because it has foreshadowing, it has a great main plot with a great hero in Russell Crowe's character. It's about love, it's about loss, it's about a warrior, it's about redemption, and it's also about longing all the way through. And the beginning of the movie, it starts with him walking through a wheat field. It looks like a wheat field. And the movie ends with that same image. And it's very, very symbolic. And that's the way you tell a story. You have a beginning, a middle, and an end. You tell them what you're going to tell them. You explain the story. And then you tell them in the end what you just told them. That's every story. That's every great story. The Gladiator does that very well. Another one is Forrest Gump.
And who was your favorite actress or celebrity to interview?
I've interviewed a lot. And that is probably the coolest thing about what I do is I've been interviewing celebrities for a long time. And one thing, to tie a couple of things together, being a military brat, I learned that you give respect and then you get respect. And you treat everyone the same, from private to general. Mm-hmm. And so that's the way I've always treated celebrities. So they're just people to me. And to say the best interview or the most entertaining one, it's tough because I've interviewed a lot of people and I've had some great conversations. Both Dustin Hoffman, he was so engaging, and he grabbed my hand, and he pulls it, and he looks at my hand, and he goes, "We're brothers." And I'm like, "What do you mean?" He goes, "I've been burned too." He thought I had been burned. And he rolls up his sleeves and shows me that he's been burned from fingertip all the way up past his elbow. You won't see that in any movie. You only see that if he shows it to you because the texture of his skin. We end up talking about vitiligo, which is the disease that I have, and about a bunch of different stuff, so much that it went over my interview time, and I hadn't even talked about him or his movie yet.
Wow.
So they give me time's up rap, and I'm like, I didn't get to talk about the movie. And Dustin's like, give this guy another slot. He you know, we're having a good conversation. But such a nice guy.
Lee Thomas has had vitiligo since he was 25, and when the cameras turn off, so does his makeup. Vitiligo is a disease that causes the loss of skin color and blotches.
Diagnosed with vitiligo, I was actually in New York. I was in New York, and I went, you know, I was working so hard. I went in between at my lunch break. I went to the doctor because I didn't think it was that big of a deal. I had a couple spots here. I had a couple in the corner of my mouth. I didn't have that many. The doctor said, you know, you have vitiligo. There is no cure, but there are treatments, or something like that, he said. Then after that, all I heard was because I literally remember looking at the guy. He looks me straight in the eyes and just told me that I have a disease and that there is no cure. And then he kept talking like it was a normal conversation. When he just told me that I have a disease that's going to turn me from black to white and there is no cure. And so I'm looking at his collar, like his tie, for like no reason. But I just hear him, and he's like, I'm like, wait a minute, did you just say there's no cure? And he's like, yes, there's no cure. But and it's like he tried to blow past it like it wouldn't have an impact on me, like I don't understand words or something. But anyway, it blew me away. I thought, you know, I thought my career was going to be over. I thought my life was going to change, you know, like it was never going to be the same. And it has. My life has changed in so many great ways. Having this disease has made me, I think, so much better as a man, like as a person. You know how vain the world is, especially working in TV?
Right.
How people are so worried about how they actually look. And the truth is it matters, but it's not the only thing that matters. And it really doesn't matter as much as they think it matters. So for me, it gave me a very grounded sense of who I actually am beyond what I look like. It gave me much more empathy and understanding for people who are different. Because there isn't a week or a 3-day period or a 4-day period, I'd say 2 days, that I'm not reminded that I have vitiligo. And it makes me stand out so uniquely. But at the same time, it makes me stand out so uniquely. Right. Like, as a reporter, I wanted to be as popular as I possibly could. And because of this disease, I think I'm more popular than I ever would have imagined as a local reporter. But even more than that, it has changed my life because I realized that people love and support you for who you are. And so many more people do that than tear you down for what you look like. And that is beyond what I thought was going to happen. And also, my story has helped other people, and those other people reading my story and supporting it have helped me. So it kind of gave me faith and love back in the human experience, that other people are there for you, yeah, and they're there for each other, and all of those things that you want this life to be, those things really exist. And I don't know if I would have known that.
And when you came out to the public on TV about your disease, how did you feel after?
All right.
Like relieved.
You know what it's like? It's like walking through a crowded room naked. That's what it was like. Because think about the thing that you think would destroy your life. Because we all have those things that we think make us so different, and people think we're so different because of whatever. Mm-hmm. You're overweight, you're too skinny, your sexuality, your hair. I mean, all these things we tell ourselves make us so different, so we keep this all inside. So then when I decided to talk about it, it was like, okay, I'm gonna strip down naked and show everybody who I am. What's gonna happen? So right after I did it, it was like that, where you hold your breath and wait for the reaction after you walk through the room.
Yeah.
So that's kind of what it was immediately after. And then we got such a flood of support and love and all of these things that I really was not expecting. Even from my bosses at the time, back when I told the story 10 years ago now, I wasn't sure what was gonna happen. But they were like, if you want to not be on camera, that's fine. If you want to stay on camera, that's fine. If you want to cover this, cover that. If you want to not wear makeup, we can talk about all of these things. And so they said, whatever you're comfortable with. So then I kind of had to baby step my way through it. It's like sticking your toe in the water and going, is it okay in the water? Is it okay? Okay, I'm putting my foot in there. Is it okay? Okay, I'll show everybody else this. You know, and I didn't mind showing my face, you know, because this kid had asked me to show it. I wasn't gonna do it. I wasn't gonna show my face without makeup, on television at least. The international spokesperson for this disease, I'm the spokesperson for the Vitiligo Society of London. I work with the Vitiligo Society in Paris, the Vitiligo Support Group in India,
wow,
in Africa, and all of these. And I know that every time I show up someplace and someone looks at my face and goes, what's up with that dude? And I tell them my name, they can Google me and find out what this is, and then maybe they'll treat the next person differently. Maybe they will have a different perspective when it comes to vitiligo. Even you seeing me without my makeup on, and you go, maybe what's wrong with this anchor? What's up with this anchor? And then you seek out the information, and all of a sudden it changes your view, perhaps, of the ride. And I really think that's what this has become for me. I put my face out there first, and because of that, it can be that thing that can change opinions for other people, even if it's just me walking through a room and people going, what's up with that? Because that's how it starts, because that's how it started with me.
Right.
I had a thing on my face, and I'm like, what's up with that?
So you embrace when people stare?
I do. I actually do. And you never know what's behind a stare.
Right.
That's the other thing. I embrace it, but I don't try to prescribe or make up a narrative about what they're thinking.
Right.
Just let them look and let them be, inquisitive perhaps. And everything else that they're thinking is on them. You can find pictures, some beautiful pictures that people have taken, people who have vitiligo. And it really is, it's strikingly beautiful. It's striking, you know, you see it. Kelly Clarkson, who I like, and it's cool. I like Kelly Clarkson, I'm still a man. Kelly Clarkson, who has a song called Beautiful Disaster. And that's what I think vitiligo is. It's so striking, so beautiful, so unique, that if you see me, you're not gonna mistake me for anybody else. But also at the same time, if you let what you think is your issue get to you, it can be a disaster. It's up to you to either look at it as a beautiful opportunity or look at it as a disaster. And for me, I've always lived my life as the whole thing is a beautiful opportunity. It just is, because nothing is promised to you. And if I live a life looking like this or that or whatever, everything else works, well, good.
So what's your advice to someone who was recently diagnosed with vitiligo or like hiding it from people?
The first thing I always tell people is whatever you're doing is okay. Whatever you have to do to get to the other side of that emotional whirlwind. Because different people go through different things. Some people feel ashamed. Some people feel scared. Some people feel like they're going to lose everything. And some people do lose a lot. I got a letter from a woman in India who her husband, because they treat you, they ostracize you in India. Her husband, married with two kids, she was hiding it from her husband. She showed her husband that she had vitiligo, and he physically threw her out of the house to never see him or the kids again. Like physically threw her out of the house and slammed the door and said, don't you ever come back. So dealing with that, I'm not gonna say, yo, you're gonna get past it and everything's okay. I will say that you can get past it, and whatever you're doing right now is okay. Because if you need to hide for a minute, go ahead and go hide. And get your support back together. While you're hiding, educate yourself on the disease, not necessarily for a cure, but look at all the other people around the globe, not just me, that are living through it. And know that you're not the only one who's walking this journey. And that can give you some solace to start walking out again. And so that's the first thing I always say, is whatever you're doing right now is okay. And the emotions that you're feeling are fine.
You have a daughter.
I do.
And just like talk about her and like when she looks at you, like you're such a strong person and so comfortable with yourself. What do you hope she sees?
You know, I think about that one a lot because I'm worried about, kids can be brutal, especially to other kids. So I used to worry about how kids would treat her because her dad has vitiligo. And it's funny, they treat her weird because her dad's on TV more than because of vitiligo, but that's a whole different thing. But for her, I hope she sees a resilient person and an empathetic person and a loving person, because that's all the things I'd love for her to be. And so I try to pour those things into her. So I hope that's what she sees in her dad, you know. But my God, I can't love her any more than anything else.
Lee continues to wear makeup when he is on camera because he doesn't want to distract from the story. If you would like to learn more about Lee and his journey with vitiligo, he has a book out called Turning White.